Well, today, these doors will not open again. Unfortunately, the lockdown has been extended, and we are doing everything that we can to stop the spread of COVID. And yes, there is a light at the end of the tunnel. You may be tired of hearing that, but we have hope. Hope in Christ. Hope that we are doing everything we can to be humble and that we are able to get back to life in its new normalcy. In saying all of that, with this lockdown being extended, we'll be completely online until January 24th when church plans to resume. We will be social distancing, using hand sanitizer, masks, and using all the protocols that we can do possible. So that will be January 24th at 10:30 a.m. for our in-person services. In saying that, also, our Bible study is going to be delayed on the book of Ephesians until January 27th. Still looking forward to that. Gives me some more time to study. Gives you some more time to just review the book of Ephesians, to read it over and over, and to become familiar with some of the aspects of that book. So I would like to encourage you to do that. Maybe begin to break it down into sections and to slowly read through it again. If you haven't already done so, please read through the book of Ephesians. But in the meantime, our offering is through e-transfer, or if you insist and you don't know how to use e-transfer, our office will remain open. Just don't everybody come all at once. You may drop off your offering either at the church or next door at the parsonage, and we will receive any givings that way. But if you are able to do e-transfer, it is at SBPC, Spring Bay Pentecostal Church, at amtelecom.net. And we are so thankful for your support. And so as we begin to go into a time of worship, let's pray. Lord, we come to you as the lockdown in Northern Ontario has been extended. And we just pray for your peace and your comfort. We just ask that you would help us to have our eyes open to those in need, that you would help us to have our ears open to your word. And so we just thank you, and we thank you in all circumstances, but we also thank you that you sent your Son who lived out that perfect sacrifice, died on the cross, was resurrected and ascended to heaven, and he sent the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit that now comforts us, lives with inside of us, and we are able to know that during this time, our God has not left us, and he will never forsake us. And so we thank you. Thank you for all you are doing for us during this time. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Greater than all we ask.
We are in the sixth week of Journeys with Joshua. And today I'm going to be talking about sin and how it can hold us back. And there's an old illustration that I want to start with. And it's about two guys, and I've decided to name them Tim and Mark. Tim and Mark, they baked some cookies. And these cookies smell very good, said Tim. He ate one. And as he ate one, they said, oh, they taste even better. And so he was so excited about these cookies. Tim ran to Mark's house. Mark, cried Tim, taste these cookies that I have made. Mark ate one of the cookies. And these are the best cookies I have ever eaten, said Mark. And Mark and Tim ate many cookies, one after another. And you know, Tim, said Mark, with his mouth full, you can just picture the cookies are still in his mouth. I think we should stop eating. We will soon be sick. And you're right, said Tim. Let us eat one last cookie, then we'll stop. And Mark and Tim, they ate one last cookie. But there were many cookies left in that bowl. And you know how that is. I have that same problem with chips. You know, if there's just any left in the bag, I just can't stop. The temptation is great. And so Tim and Mark had the same problem. And so Tim goes, Mark, let us eat one very last cookie and then we'll stop. So Mark and Tim ate one very last cookie. We must stop eating, cried Tim, as he ate another. Yes, said Mark, reaching for another cookie. We need willpower. What is willpower? Asked Tim. Willpower is trying hard not to do something you really want to do, said Mark. You mean like trying hard not to eat all of these cookies? Asked Tim. Right, said Mark. So Mark put the cookies in a box. There, he said, now we will not be able to eat any more cookies. But we can open the box, said Tim. Well, that is true, said Mark. So Tim tied some string around the box and said, there, now we will not eat any more cookies. But we can cut the string and open the box, said Tim. Well, this is true, said Mark. So Mark got on a ladder and he put the box up on a high shelf. There, said Mark, now we will not eat any more cookies. But we can climb the ladder and take the box down from the shelf and cut the string and open the box, said Tim. Well, that is true, said Mark. So Mark climbed the ladder, he took the box down from the shelf, he cut the string and he opened the box. And then Mark took the box outside and he shouted in a loud voice, here, birds, here are some cookies. Birds came from everywhere. They picked up all the cookies in their beaks and they flew away. Now we have no more cookies to eat, said Tim sadly. Not even one. Yes, said Mark, but we have lots and lots of willpower. Well, you may keep it all, Mark, said Tim. I'm going home now to bake a cake. You know, temptation is tough. And for the last couple of weeks, I've been encouraging us to get alone with God and to consecrate ourselves to essentially come near to God so that he will come near to us. To be silent in his presence so that if he should speak, we would be able to hear his voice. And probably the number one question that I get asked whenever I talk about how God speaks to me is, what does God sound like? Some may even look at me like I have two heads when I tell them I hear from God. And I'm sure there are still others who would like to have me committed in an insane asylum for saying I talk to God and he responds. However, the number one problem when it comes to listening to God is when we sin or when we do wrong, essentially when we succumb to temptation. And I don't believe it's because God separates himself from us. It even says in the book of Romans, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all of these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. I think it has more to do with us. You know, we tend to want to hide from God when we do wrong. The guilt at times overwhelms us. And maybe we even decide not to go to church, or we decide to surround ourselves with, other believers. You know, we hide from them when things go wrong because of the shame that we feel. The struggle becomes real. And I even recently read that religion says, if you'll stop sinning, God will fill you with his Spirit. Scripture teaches, be filled with the Spirit and you'll stop sinning. However, I read that statement, I was like, there's something wrong with that. It just didn't sit right. The closest idea that I could find that might come close to that statement is Galatians 5:15, where it tells us that if you walk by the Spirit, you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. So I will say, we as believers, we definitely, without a shadow of a doubt, we need the Holy Spirit in our lives. And as we walk with him, it's much like a parent holding your hand as you're trying to get across a busy intersection or maybe a dangerous parking lot. That parent is guiding the child. That parent is showing the child where to go. And it is up to the child to continue to listen, to continue to hold the hand of the person that is leading them. And that's what the Holy Spirit does in our lives. It doesn't stop us from sinning. He guides us, he leads us, he directs us. And if we listen to him, we won't sin. But at times, if we disregard what he has to say to us, we could very much fall into sin. And as Spirit-filled believers, we still do wrong. We are not perfect. And as soon as we commit our lives to Christ, we're still not perfect. We still struggle because we are in a fallen world. And as we continue to look at the book of Joshua, we see very much the same idea. One big difference, the Israelites didn't have the gift of the Holy Spirit. Didn't have that gift that we do now. But at the same time, there are huge similarities. So as we're going to jump to the 7th chapter of the book of Joshua, we had left the Israelites. They were being interrupted by God. They wanted to push ahead. They wanted to destroy Jericho, but God said, wait. He had a plan. He wanted them to march around the wall once a day for 6 days. And then on the 7th day, and this is just in summary, but on the 7th day, he wanted them to walk around the wall 7 times and to blow the trumpet, and the walls would come crashing down. And so, as insane as a plan that is, they did what God asked them to do, and it worked out in their favor. The walls came tumbling down, and they, for the most part, did as they were commanded and destroyed everything in the city. But as we get to verse 1 of chapter 7, something we notice happened. One person out of probably a couple of a million did something wrong. Now, hey, I would be like, great, 1 out of 2 million. It's a good record. However, it was different with God. See, God commanded through Joshua that no one would take anything that was accursed. Accursed is the word that is probably used in the ESV or the King James Version, accursed. In other words, they weren't to take anything that would be associated with demons or anything that had to do with the worship of other gods. They were not to take anything like that. They were to destroy it. But right away in the first chapter, or first verse of chapter 7, we have one person that took an item or items that were cursed.
And so Joshua didn't know this yet. And he sends his spies to the city of Ai. This would be the next place on the list to take over. So he sends his spies. We don't know how many spies, 2, 12, a couple thousand. The reality of the situation is none of this matters. Even the spies come back with this report in verse 3 where it says, "And they returned to Joshua and said to him, 'Do not have all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and attack Ai. Do not make the whole people toil up there, for they are few.'" Now, compared to Jericho, this battle was going to be a piece of cake, a walk in the park. Essentially, they had nothing to worry about. An easy victory was about to happen. So they send 3,000 men, but they lose. 36 Israelites died in this battle. They were chased away. As it says in verse 5, their hearts began to melt and they became like water. And they just didn't understand why they lost. None of this made sense. God promised them. Therefore, Joshua, who feared that God was being unfaithful to them, did the following as we pick up the account in verse 6, where it says, "Then Joshua tore his clothes and fell to the earth on his face before the ark of the Lord until the evening, he and the elders of Israel. And they put dust on their heads. And Joshua said, 'Alas, O Lord God, why have you brought this people over the Jordan at all to give us into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us? With that, we had been content to dwell beyond the Jordan. O Lord, what can I say? When Israel has turned their backs before their enemies, for the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land will hear of it and will surround us and cut off our name from the earth. And what will you do for your great name?'" Now, Joshua tore his clothes. And to tear your clothes and to put dust on your head displays mourning. But Joshua is not mourning the death of the 36 men. Instead, he is mourning the loss of a blessing, the loss of the guidance of God. And at times, this is what happens when we sin. We have this tendency to move away from God, and in that moving away process, we begin to lose his blessing and the guidance in our lives. But we need to remember one thing: God has never failed us. Right now, Joshua believes that. And at times, we might feel like God has left us, but he never leaves us. The word says he never forsakes us. And it is us who move away from God. But in Joshua's plea, he even expresses that it would have been better if they had not come to the promised land at all. If God did not deliver them, all would be lost. What was the point? And how this is so different from today. Or it's not so different from today. We are filled with so many programs. That oftentimes we rely on these programs. It's so much so that we don't even notice that God withdraws from us. We get so reliant on the way things always are that we need to be careful not to treasure a church program so much that we mistake it for always being God's will. There are times in church history when essentially a program needs to die. And I'm not saying something is being canceled right now. I'm just saying times in our lives, a program needs to die in order for God to do something new, to reach out to a new generation. A church at times needs to let go of the way it's always been done and realize that when something is no longer working to fulfill the Great Commission, if it's just being done to bring us pleasure, then we're being selfish. We've become a social club, and we need to rethink what we are doing in order to do what God has called us to do. And these are hard questions we have to ask ourselves at times. And when we keep something of our own, we become selfish. We come close to sinning. When in turns,
When in turn we move further away from God, but only because we move from him, not the other way around. And therefore, I believe God would answer us in similar ways today as he answered Joshua in verse 10 of chapter 7, where he says, "The Lord said to Joshua, 'Get up. Why have you fallen on your face? Israel has sinned. They have transgressed my covenant that I commanded you. They have taken some of the devoted things. They've stolen and lied and put them among their own belongings.'" Here's the good news. God never failed the nation. Of course not. But here's the bad news. They were defeated due to the sin of one person. And Joshua doesn't need to fear that the problem was with God anymore. And we can do the same. The problem is never God. The problem is us. And this is also why God told Joshua to get up. He didn't need to beg God to change his heart towards Israel. Joshua had to change Israel's heart before God. And this is the trouble with being a leader or even a pastor. We at times know when we have to bring change, and we at least know that there will be at least one person that might not like the change. And to be honest, at times I pray that it's only one person and not a group of people. But the change needs to happen in order to allow for God to continue to work, that he can do what he wants to do. And when it comes to the sin in our lives, Paul wrote this in his first letter to the Corinthian church: "Your boasting is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump?" Now, what does Paul mean by that? Just a small amount of sin that becomes accepted or even tolerated among believers can infect the whole group. And as the account of Joshua carries on, we learn that the effect of the sin caused by just one person caused them to no longer have power over their enemies. They couldn't even defeat the small community of Ai. And we ourselves can become powerless. But we must remember, we are not under the same covenant. This is where the differences are. They, the Israelites, were different. Our position with God is made by the work of Jesus on our behalf and not our works. Yet if we want God's power and presence in our battles, we must walk in the Spirit, which can be hindered by our sin, by our rebellion. Now, the end of today's account in Joshua ends well for the nation, but not for the one person. You see, Joshua did not know who it was, but a secret sin on earth can be an open scandal to God, because God knows all. And once God was able to deal with that one person, he was able to bless the whole nation. Even this kind of sin, which is can be dealt with, can be a springboard to victory again. Israel was once again ready to walk in the power and guidance of God. And for us, this kind of victory, especially over a repetitive sin, has to have a death. We need to die. We need to die to such habitual wrongs in our lives and know that those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. You see, the power and the victory of Jesus' resurrection are ours as we crucify our flesh with him every day. What does that mean? That means we wake up in the morning and we make a choice. We choose to live for Christ. We choose to live for him and not ourselves. When we live for ourselves, we become selfish, greedy, maybe jealous with fits of anger and willing to cause division. However, if we choose to live for Christ, the exact opposite will happen. We have love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
But it's a choice we need to make every day of our lives. And today, I encourage you, ask the Holy Spirit to examine your life. Is there something you need to give up? Is there a secret sin, or is there even a selfish desire within you that you don't want something to change? Ask God to speak to you today. Let Him give you the answers, because I want to encourage you to live a life full of the Spirit, free of sin, and ready to answer when God calls you into action, because this is available to everyone, no matter what we have done. So open your heart today. Open your heart to what the Spirit has to say. Lord, we come before you with an open heart and with an open mind, and we ask that your Holy Spirit would speak to us today. Is there something in our lives that should not be there? Tell us. Help us. Encourage us. Guide us. Whatever it might be, help us to remove it from our lives so that we can move forward as individuals and as a church, as a body of believers, as brothers and sisters in Christ. And we can do better. None of us are perfect. All of us have fallen short of your glory. But you, with the gift that you have given us with Jesus' death and resurrection on the cross, are able to look past all of that, and you see a bright future for us. And so we thank you. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for being a part of our lives. And we thank you for being there for us in these present day circumstances, knowing that there is a bright future and a bright hope ahead of us. And so we just thank you for it all. In Jesus' precious name, amen. And so I want to encourage you today. I don't know who is watching, but if you are interested in giving your life to Christ, please message the church. Email us at sbpc@amtelecom.net. Or reach out by telephone, check out our website. Do whatever you can to find somebody that will help you in that process. We want to be there for you. At the same time, feel free to share this video in case there is somebody that will benefit from this message. Leave a word of encouragement for others to see and be encouraged that there are others walking with us, other brothers and sisters in Christ, that we are not alone. But in the meantime, stay safe, stay healthy. Stay in prayer and stay close to God, because He loves you. God bless.